everybody. Welcome to episode number 195 of the SoxProspects.com podcast. Coming up on episode 200, the countdown is on. We are the web's number one source for information on the Boston Red Sox farm system from top to bottom, from Fort Myers to Pawtucket and all stops in between. Thank you for listening. My name is Chris Hatfield, and I am the executive editor of Sox Prospects, and I'm joined, as always, by our director of scouting, Ian Kundle. Ian, part two. We finally figured out that 2 hours is probably too long for a single podcast.
Just a little long.
So this is going to be part two of an episode we recorded back just before Halloween, but it's all still timely, I believe, based on the way we cut it. And we're going to add some new stuff, of course, because some new stuff has happened. But yeah, we're finally figuring things out at episode 195.
Well, I mean, maybe not, because if you hadn't said anything, I don't think they would have even noticed that.
No, I'm just saying we're smart. No, I'm saying we're getting smart enough to not put out 2-hour-long podcasts.
Exactly.
No one wants to listen.
I know a lot of people would like the 2-hour podcast, but
I guess that's true.
It sometimes is better to split it up because.
Yeah. Well, now we get to talk about new stuff.
Exactly.
We get to talk about new stuff. So we're going to talk about some new stuff today. We've got minor league free agent day came, and the Red Sox re-signed a bunch of guys already. I think I'm the one who actually broke that they re-signed them all.
You did, except for one.
Except for one. Cotillo got me on that one.
Yes.
Damn you, Cotillo. But, yeah, minor league free agents. Some guys re-signed, some didn't. We'll talk about that. The Red Sox have a coach, Ian, and they've got
They have a manager.
A manager. Good point. Thank you. That's what it's called. They've got a manager. They brought back a pro scout. Why do we care? We'll talk about that. And a new pro scout we should probably mention briefly now that I think about
it.
So we've got that going on. I don't think we mentioned a couple of other things. Joe Oliver we should probably mention briefly. Didn't talk about him in the last episode, although that was out. But we've got that as well as some stuff we've talked about, including important off-season calendar dates. Latest on the MLB-MILB negotiations, which actually we're probably going to need to update next episode. I don't know how much we have new to add this time, but maybe we'll try and tack that on. We'll see. This is going to be a grab bag episode, folks. We don't even know what's coming up. It'll be fun. And of course, as always, we have your emails, podcast@soxprospects.com. We want to talk about what you want to hear about. So we've got a bunch of your emails at the end of this episode. So another banner set of the listeners have been stepping up to the plate for a few months now.
Very much so.
In a big way. Not that the emails were bad before, but I think we've pretty consistently had like 5 or 6 really good emails per episode. So let's keep that up, folks. We appreciate it. And as always, if you want to support the podcast, you can do so on patreon.com/SoxProspects. Pledge a certain amount per episode, and you get some perks that come with it. And our $5 level Patreon supporters get personal shout-outs. That list includes Kyle Costigan, Tyler Woodrall, Jeff Traynor, David Nardone, Tim Harding, Bill Stanton, Deb Kendall, Evan Kirkwood, Hurricanes 1, Chris Fox, James O'Hara, Nathan Kendon, Andrew Wallen, David B., Ben Burnett, Al Mendel, Kevin Catrides, Ben NRI, Paul Denyer, Lendl Martin, Cassandra Book, James P. McMahon, Stephen Gregory, and James Bailey. Thank you all for your support, and thank you to all of our patrons over at patreon.com/SoxProspects. Ian, where do we want to start? Let's start with some of the newsy stuff. And then we'll tag on the less newsy stuff. Since our last episode, I guess before our last episode, I think, it was announced that Portland Sea Dogs manager Joe Oliver was among the folks who'd been laid off much earlier in the year. I think it was like during the season or early in the season that those layoffs happened. It was a bunch of pro scouts. There were a few pro scouts. It was August. Okay. Yeah, that sounds right. But did not have his contract removed. Renewed, not removed. It was removed. Did not have his contract renewed. Really, Ian, it's just a numbers game is what it comes down to.
I mean, there's going to be one less affiliate, so there's one less coaching staff is needed, and it's unfortunate seeing someone lose their job or not get their contract renewed, but I mean, this is what MLB and the owners wanted. They want to have fewer players on the payroll, fewer coaches, fewer staff, and that's why they want to cut down the number of affiliates.
Yeah, so that's, so Joe Oliver, happy trails, best of luck to you. That happened. Unfortunate, but, I think the team is really high on a lot of the other managers they have, and
Yeah, I think that's what it is. It's just a numbers game.
Yeah, it's a numbers game, and they like some of the younger Iggy Suarez. I'm trying to think who else they have. Corey Wemberly was the Salem manager last year.
Darren Fenster,
who they love as well. Although Fenster, where was Fenster last year?
He was high A, wasn't he?
He was high A. No, Wemberly was high A.
Was he Greenville? No, Iggy was Greenville.
Fenster's the roaming infield guy now.
Was he? Okay.
Yeah. But they
used to be the Greenville manager.
Yeah, he was.
Because Greenville was Iggy last year. Because Lowell was Luke Montz.
Yep, who's probably going to move up to Greenville, I bet.
And then Salem was Wimberly. Yep. Portland was
Oliver and
Joe AAA. Oliver. And AAA was
McMillan.
Billy McMillan, mm-hmm. Right?
Yep. And by last year, we mean 2 years ago.
Yeah, 2 years ago.
They like a lot of the guys they have, and Oliver just kind of gets squeezed out. Probably can talk more about the minor league, major league thing next episode, just because it's such a moving target. We can talk about it today, and it's going to be old news tomorrow.
Yeah, I feel like we're going to get news in the next couple of weeks about the Red Sox affiliates.
Yeah, we talk about it later in the episode. We can tack that on there. Yeah. Also, minor league free agency. The way minor league free agency works is 5 days after the World Series ends. Just like how that's when major leaguers that's the end of the major league exclusive negotiating period. I think it's immediately after the World Series, major league free agents are declared free agents, but minor league free agents aren't free agents until 5 days after the World Series. It's if you have played 7 seasons in the minors. So as long as you played parts of 7 seasons in the minors, you become a free agent. Pretty big list this year, honestly, Ian. I think it seems bigger than, I don't know if it's bigger than usual, but it's a large list. You can see it on the transactions page, Sox Prospects. Some of the key guys, there are guys on there who literally never played a game for the Red Sox.
I think why it's so long, too, is part of those, some of these guys would have been released in season, frankly.
Spring training. Or before the, yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
or before
and the then season. The other thing is obviously they're cutting an affiliate, so they don't need as many guys.
So. They still would have been minor league free agents.
Fair, but I'm saying they might have brought back more if they were keeping.
I don't know, but they re-signed 2, 4, 6, 8, 9 guys.
Yeah,
which
true.
Is a lot more than usual, it feels like.
Let's get back.
I mean, some of the guys who've been around for a while who are now minor league free agents, pitcher Emmanuel De Jesus, pitcher Jonathan Diaz. Robinson Lair, who pitched for the Red Sox this year. Zue Lin, who I think was like the third longest tenured guy on the 40-man, mm-hmm. is now a free agent. Nick Longhi, who never got to suit up in his second stint with the Red Sox unless they re-sign him. Daniel McGrath, who had re-signed as a minor league free agent last year, and I think that's just getting squeezed out by the fact that, Connor Seabold is here now. Bryan Mata's a year older. Just kind of squeezed out of that. They didn't need the AAA depth as much anymore. Jeremy Rivera. Good fielding shortstop. Kevin Steen is technically a free agent. He was a player of the Red Sox drafted, who folks might remember was involved in a horrible accident down in Fort Myers during extended spring training. Has required a number of surgeries on his legs. As far as I can tell on social media, it looks like he's living a normal life now, which is great because that was a really scary situation, but he's technically a free agent now. Mm-hmm. Cole Sturgeon, one of those kind of senior signs who got all the way up to AAA, very valuable member. I think he's a guy who's going to kick around.
He's going to land somewhere.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, he's like the quintessential org player, mm-hmm. like mm-hmm. has a great defender, puts the ball in play, not much pop, but you stick him in the 8-9 slot in the lineup and he does a professional job every day.
Yep. Yep. All right. Well, in addition to the guys they lost, Ian, the Red Sox re-signed a number of guys. I'm going to read all of them. Maybe we can go through them one by one with a brief bit on each. Roldani, Baldwin, been with the team a while. Promise that he could hit at some point. Never really realized. Missed all of 2019, basically, due to an injury, and then obviously missed all of this year. So, there's a recovering from an injury piece to it there. And just jump in if you have anything on any of these guys. Seth Blair, a pitcher who the Red Sox only signed in August. No surprise that they re-signed him.
He looked pretty good at the alternate site.
Yeah, changed his arm slot, really kind of remade himself. Great story about how he basically made his backyard into a training area for pitchers.
We should also mention, I forgot, on Baldwin that he is at Instructs right now.
Yeah, we should have realized when he got invited to Instructs that they were going to resign him. I don't know why. Well, they
have, because he couldn't be there.
Well, no, he would have like had to leave in the middle, because Instructs started before the World Series ended.
But yeah, he actually had a long home run off Jay Groome a few days ago. Mm-hmm. So he's showing off a little pop. He's also by far, I think, the oldest guy there. So it's kind of, you know, one of those.
Yeah, but he's one of the more advanced guys, at least. Mm-hmm. Raynel Espinal is a player that the Red Sox got from the Yankees in the minor league Rule 5 draft last offseason. So he hasn't pitched for the team yet.
He was going to miss the season with shoulder.
I think he just came back. He's in a similar boat to Baldwin, where I think he missed 2019.
Yeah, he pitched a little bit in 2019. I thought he had TJ mid 2019, but I'm not positive. It's not in there.
That's annoying.
I
think it like wasn't reported, like Pinstripes Prospects had it or something.
That's what I mean. I'm pretty sure he had it last year, because he's like 29 already. Yeah. So.
Steven Gonsalves is a guy the Red Sox claimed off waivers.
He's not 29. I lied.
Okay.
He's 27. Page is wrong.
Got it. Steven Gonsalves is a guy who the Red Sox picked up off waivers from, where was he when they got him? Philly? The Mets. The Reds?
Mets, right?
Mets. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Was it still the Mets? Okay. Cause he was a Twins prospect, went to the Mets. That's true.
He was like a borderline top 100 guy with the Twins back in the day.
He was a top 100 guy with the Twins.
Oh, was he? Okay.
Yeah, I'm fairly certain. I remember like almost drafting him in fantasy baseball minor league drafts multiple years.
Yeah.
You know, post-hype prospect at this point. Cleared waivers while he was at the alternate training site. The Red Sox re-signed him. Really liked him out of the bullpen. Velocity ticked up near the end of camp.
Mm-hmm.
Working in shorter outings. So, you know, a guy who will probably see throw out of the bullpen next year. Joey Meneses and Johan Mieses are two guys the Red Sox signed just before spring training this year and brought into camp. They're going to be keeping the two of them around there. Both Meneses is a first baseman outfielder. Mieses is an outfielder. Both are playing winter ball as well. Josh Ockimey, first baseman, who's been around for a bit. Kind of interesting, Ian, is it completely out of the question he hits his way into being some kind of platoon partner with Dahlbeck at some point? Maybe not to start the season, but in an injury situation or something like that?
No, I still think he can, like, hit righties at an MLB level. Maybe not to be a starter, but, like, as a, you know, a platoon bench bat, I think there's – his problem is his lack of defensive versatility, and he just can't hit lefties at all.
Right.
But, I mean, I think when it comes with him, if you look at the minor league depth chart, they just have nothing at corner, first base, in the high minors.
Well, that's part of why they had to bring him into the ATS. They had no left-handed hitters. They had no – I thought I had this on vibrate. I apparently don't. Yeah, they had no left-handed hitters. They had, you know, very little on the corners. So it made sense to bring him in.
Yeah, and, like, it's one of these things where – him starting as the first baseman in Pawtucket / Worcester next year. I guess it's Worcester now, we can say.
Worcester, yeah.
But it makes sense. Like, he performed, you know, reasonably well in AAA in 2019. I think he hit, 25 home runs or something?
Yeah, he hit for some power, that's for sure.
He just couldn't hit. His average was brought down by his inability to hit lefties. But, yeah, I mean, he's a solid guy right now, and maybe there's a chance. He's still only, like, I think 25, that maybe he can unlock something at the plate and he can get up to the big leagues at some point.
Yeah. Jhonny Pereda is the player the Red Sox got from the Cubs for – help me here.
Hmm? They got Jhonny Pereda at Lakens, Travis Lakens.
For Travis Lakens, that's right. He's the player not a player named later, I think it was at the time. Catcher who they have him as re-signed. I'm pretty sure what probably happened is there was this weird transaction before the alternate training site roster was announced where he was like listed as released and re-signed the next day. It wouldn't surprise me if that was a 2-year contract that he re-signed. But anyways, he's going to be back.
Always good to have catching depth.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, he can handle himself behind the plate. He's an intriguing prospect. I think, is he in the back of our top 60 right now, or did he get squeezed out?
I think he's in the very back, but yeah, he could have. He's, if not, he's going to get squeezed out, but yeah, he's somewhere back there.
I think he got squeezed out. I think he was at the very tail end and he got squeezed out by the new acquisitions. Yeah, I think he might've been 60 before they acquired Wallace. Mm-hmm. So he's maybe 61 or 62. Intriguing catcher. And Caleb Simpson, a pitcher who they claimed off waivers from the Phillies, the Red Sox did. They really liked him in camp. I think it's good stuff. He just needs to learn where it's going.
Yeah, it's similar to Seth Blair. I think that he was impressive. And by the end of camp, those two were really the only guys throwing consistently. So the Red Sox, given how much they were using them, clearly were interested in getting a look at them. And yeah, it'll be interesting to see what they do next year.
Yep. So those are guys sticking around, probably all ticketed for AAA if they stick around. Oh, no, Baldwin, I would say probably AA. Maybe I could see one of those guys going to AA, too. Maybe Pereda to AA.
I think Pereda starts in AAA. I think that Connor Wong probably starts at AA as your starting catcher.
You think?
Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah, I guess I could see that. I could see that. Anywho, yeah, so that interesting list of guys who're sticking around. The other transactions we should mention, first of all, the Red Sox declined Martin Perez's 2021 contract option, which I hope was in the last episode because we talked about it. For the reasons we talk about, they're not really a surprise again.
No, in this market, it was just too much. And, you know, it sucks because he obviously really liked being in Boston and wanted to stay, but it was just too much money to give him. And I think the market will show that because I don't think he'll get even $5 million, honestly, in a one-year deal. Like, I just – the way this market is trending, like, free agency's been open for, what, like, 5 days now, and the only person who signed is Rod Ray.
Yeah.
And I think that was partially – he got $8 million, which is a little more – about a million and a bit more than what Perez would have got. Uh-huh. Robbie Ray's a more upside, better pitcher, maybe. I mean, he might not be a better pitcher, but has more upside. And I think it also played in that Toronto gave up something for him at the deadline, so they felt kind of obligated to bring him back and give a longer look to him.
Yeah, I mean, they knew what they were getting, and they wanted to lock him. I mean, it's the Dave Dombrowski, we want to get our guy before the market really kind of starts setting up move.
And, which, I mean, he was decent with Toronto, I believe. Like, he's like a 4. Yeah, I mean, he was like a 4.7 ERA. Like,
right.
Whatever. Right.
I mean, it is what it is. Another move to mention is that Josh Tobias retired. Tobias was a minor league infielder for the Red Sox. He was their return from the Phillies for Clay Buchholz way back in, maybe not as far back as I thought it was going to be, but December 2016.
Yeah.
It did not seem like Clay Buchholz was on this team in 2016, but
yeah,
it was that recent. Got up to AAA last year.
We had 291 in AAA last year.
What's that?
He had 291 in AAA.
Yeah, in 44 games. He dealt with some injuries last year. He could hit for average a little bit. You know, he had a really good, short stint in Portland last year after struggling the year before, hit his way up to AAA and he hit pretty well there as well, but, probably limited to second base, not a great fielder there either. And not necessarily a top notch bat, but, he is joining the Red Sox as a pro scout following the path that, Kyrie Washington had. So he will stay with the organization.
Mm-hmm.
But that is basically it. For recent transactions, Ian.
Yeah, so, there's been not a lot of movement, and I feel like the market is going to be slow to develop, so we could be here a while.
Last thing in news-wise we should probably discuss, Ian, is the return of Alex Cora. The Red Sox held their press conference today. What are your thoughts? I will just open the floor to you on that.
I mean, I don't think there was any other choice, I'll be honest. Like, I think they had to go through the process because at the end of the day, this is Chaim Bloom's hire, and I feel like ownership didn't want to be seen as like forcing the hire down on him. But it was pretty clear the players wanted him back. The front office ownership wanted him back. Like, the remaining holdovers from the front office wanted him back. It made too much sense not to bring him back, and I think it's the right move. I think he deserved his punishment. I still think he kind of got screwed by Houston in that regards, that they kind of railroaded him.
The players, you mean?
They kind of threw him under the bus because he wasn't with the org anymore. And
sure seems
I mean, I think the biggest thing for me is the players. I just think it would have been problematic if they brought in someone new and all the players clearly wanted Cora back. Like, Matt Barnes said as much on the radio. And I think Eduardo Rodriguez, maybe one of the other guys that talked about it too. They really respect Cora. Cora like connects with the players on a really good level, especially Devers. I think I wonder if Cora not being there kind of influenced Devers' play somewhat this year. I think he's a really good manager. I think that it's going to be good for the Red Sox going forward. And I think the Red Sox did a good job protecting themselves too. They talked about in the meeting that, you know, he's under no, there's going to be like, no, there's no tolerance for anything. If there's any shenanigans, he's gone. And they only gave him a 2-year deal with a couple option years. So if something, you know, if something happens, they're not on the hook for a long-term deal.
Yeah, I think it's, you know, even if Heim Bloom liked Sam Fold better, I think he needed to like him a lot better. You know what I mean? It's like we talk about sometimes with transactions. It's like, yeah, you might like a guy out there better, but you have to like him a lot better to make it worth the acquisition cost. In this case, I think, especially with the players, I think that's a key point you made, that enough players wanted him to come back and felt strongly about it, that if you bring in a Sam Fold, if you bring in, who was the other finalist?
The guy from the Yankees, I think.
No, it wasn't the guy from the Yankees.
Oh, I don't know.
It was a different guy. It wasn't the Pirates guy either. I forget. But anyway.
It wasn't the Diamondbacks guy, was it?
It might have been. But anyway.
I think it was those two were clearly the finalists.
Yeah, though. I mean, it's look, Heim Bloom's got a history with Sam Fold.
Yeah.
And he really liked him, and he clearly was really considering him, and Fold's name seems to come up for every opening.
He's going to be a manager in the next year or two anyway. Like, but just with the Red Sox.
He'd have been punching uphill.
It was always going to be Cora to me. And yeah, it was just, they had to go through the motions of a search, but at the end of the day, they settled on the right person, in my opinion.
Well, I mean, you know, look, I'm torn on the man served his punishment for what he did. We still, as lay people, don't really know his role.
No.
Because the report office basically pins it on him and Beltran, it seems like. I don't think it's a coincidence that they were the two guys who weren't there anymore.
Correct.
That said, it's clear he was heavily involved with setting the system up today. He talked about how he didn't bring a system like that to Boston. Because
they told him not to.
Because they told him they didn't want to do anything like that.
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty clear that he was involved in some capacity. I don't believe he was the mastermind, like, villain that they made him out to be.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we don't know, but it seems like they're... the front office and who was left kind of just pinned it on him and Beltran, as you said. And yeah, did he deserve to be punished for being a part of it? Yeah. But I don't think it was a disqualifying, you know, thing similar to AJ Hinch. I don't think it should have made it so they never managed again.
Right. Yeah. And I think, look, they were given a penalty and served it. I mean, I know Cora today talked about how he thought he would be out of the game for 2 or 3 years.
Yeah.
I'll
be honest, I think there's other managers in the MLB who were recently hired who should be punished for what they did.
Or just say it, Tony La Russa. I mean, that story's incredible.
That Cora got a year and Tony La Russa gets a DUI, like, announced the day before, or whatever it was, he was charged with a DUI the day before he was hired, is ludicrous to me. I cannot believe the White Sox did that. It blows my mind, honestly.
Well, I mean, he's a Hall of Famer.
Yeah, that's true. I mean,
he's a Hall of Famer.
Can you see my ring? But, like, I just think that, like, yeah, I think what Tony La Russa did is worse than what Alex Cora did.
Alex Cora couldn't have killed anyone.
Yeah, exactly. So I just think that Cora, you know, he served his time and it's time to move on. He didn't do that with the Red Sox. He was not punished for anything he did with the Red Sox. And I think that's the key with me. If it was something that happened with the Red Sox, I would have been not in favor of bringing him back. But it was something that happened before he was a manager when he was with another team. And that is a big difference for me.
It's not for me.
Really?
Because they didn't know about it when they hired him.
Yeah.
So I don't think that's...
I think, though, if they knew about it when they hired him and then did the same thing with the Red Sox and MLB found that out, I don't think they bring him back.
Well, he would have been, banned if he did the same thing again.
Fair.
Like, he would have gotten more than a year. And here's the thing, too, that I wanted to mention, because I've seen a lot of people responding with, why didn't they just suspend him for a year if they were just going to bring him back? You have to remember the timeline. In January, the Astros report comes out. Cora had not been disciplined yet.
Yeah.
They explicitly said they were holding off on disciplining Cora until they finished the investigation into the Red Sox.
Which cost them their second round pick.
In 2018.
Yeah.
And that didn't come down until April, remember?
Yeah.
So... the reason what happened in January is the way it came, they described it today, is Cora went into Heim Bloom's office or whoever's office it was and says, I can't manage this team this year. And they agreed, you can't.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
They everyone was in agreement, like, yes, this can't happen. They didn't know what the, if they knew at that point Cora's getting suspended for 1 year, they may have just suspended him for a year.
Yeah.
They let him go because you couldn't go into camp with a manager who was probably getting suspended. Mm-hmm. Yes, I guess they could have indefinitely suspended him, but now you're bringing in a lame duck manager.
Well, it's also, yeah, that's the thing is like...
You're cutting Renicky's legs out from underneath him before he even gets going.
And it also, it just, all anyone will ask about is Cora. You know what I mean? It just makes the focus is Cora, 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 which is the last thing you want going into a season, mm-hmm. is like the questions about the manager every day.
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
so they didn't have much choice.
That's, but that's why they did it that way. It's not disingenuous to bring him back now, because by the time April rolls around and they hear what the punishment is, you're committed to Renicky.
Yeah.
You're committed to Renicky for the season, and I think there was the right move to get rid of Renicky. Renicky wasn't the guy for this team going forward.
He's not a good manager.
No, like, I didn't like him as a manager. I think some of the moves, I mean, like, we could talk all day about that, and we shouldn't, but... You know, just the disconnect there. Some of the moves didn't make any sense at all. Mm-hmm. Cora, like we said, I think he's the right guy. I think they were able to get... Look, I'm a criminal defense lawyer. I'm big on you serve your punishment and then you reintegrate with society. Mm-hmm. Right? You get out. You shouldn't not be able to live your life.
Yeah.
If you've learned from something and moved on from it. If you have... serve the punishment that in that case society has deemed is appropriate, and in this case that Major League Baseball has deemed as appropriate. As a team, you don't have to be okay with it. As a fan, you don't have to be okay with them rehiring him because of what Cora did. If you're upset that they rehired him, I completely get it.
You know, is anyone upset with them rehiring him though?
There are a number of people in our forum who are pissed about it. Yeah, who are absolutely pissed. Now, I think that some of it is maybe being a little contrarian and taking a moral high ground disingenuously.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm sure some of those same people rooted for Clay Buchholz while he was a pitcher, even though, you know, while he was a pitcher with the Red Sox, even though he had like stolen laptops from his college's computer lab. I'm sure, you know, there are plenty of people who, you know, I question the genuine nature of the sentiment. But if you genuinely are upset that the Red Sox have hired Alex Cora, I think that's completely defensible. And frankly, I'm still kind of working through how I feel about it. Don't tell me that you root for Bill Belichick and you're upset with Alex Cora.
Yeah, I guess we differ there. I'm fine with it. I think it was the only move. I think it's the right move. I think he's one of the best managers in baseball. And I think that, you know, going forward, he's the right man to lead this team as they look to rebuild and kind of right the ship after last year's disaster.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think on field that there's no question. I don't think anyone's saying on field he isn't. I'm just saying I think it depends on whether you are okay with someone with that black mark on their resume.
Yeah. I mean, I guess we have – I just don't view the black mark like some of the other people do. I think it's a different – I think all of those need to be looked at with context.
Yeah, and I think that the important context there is the fact that, look – it's not like no one in baseball attempts to steal signs, and the Astros had this massive thing trying to do it. They clearly went way too far.
Yeah.
And that's at all levels of the organization, by the way. Like, Alex Cora didn't send an intern out to photograph the Yankees dugout.
No.
With a phone. Like, when I see things like Jeff Lunau.
Oh, my God. You saw that.
Denying that he knew anything about it.
He's suing the team now.
Garbage. Yeah, well, he's clearly doing it because he thinks they'll settle. Trust me. As an attorney, like,
oh, no, 100%,
there's no chance he wins.
Yeah, well, but there's also no chance they want this to go to trial because discovery will be a field day.
Yeah, oh, yeah. They are going to settle with him before discovery. And, I mean, that's the kind of guy you're dealing with here.
Yeah.
Right?
He's never going to work in baseball again, Jeff.
No, and I think he knows that.
Confidently. And I think he knows that, and that's why he's doing this.
Yeah. So... I mean, it was an organization filled with scoundrels. I mean, who was the guy? I'm so happy we traded for Roberto Osuna.
The Brandon Town and Tannenbaum, like assistant GM.
Yeah.
Like, and this was the thing. Like, Andrew the Taubman Astros cheating was the worst kept secret in baseball. Let's be honest here. Like,
every team knew. I mean, Trevor Bauer referred to it on Twitter. Like,
but like every like this was things like it even filtered down to like I knew. Like, it was known like years before it ever came public that they were doing this. So it's like,
it's just someone blew the whistle,
or not, maybe not cheating, but whatever you want to call it, you know, pushing the boundaries of what you can do.
No, I call it cheating. Okay. I definitely call it cheating. I think MLB had done a very poor job defining what was cheating. But like,
I don't want to be held liable, so I just wanted to clear that up.
You're not going to be held liable for calling it cheating. There was an investigation. Well,
and I think we should also remind people that this is the same team that fired their entire scouting department, pro scouting department, as soon as the trade deadline ended in the year they won the World Series, just cut costs. Like, this is the kind of people we're dealing with.
Yeah.
They're not,
It's not a good organization. Jim Crane's a terrible owner. I'll go on the record for that. Anyway, all right. So that's the news, Ian. Let's move on to some other stuff that we talked about recently.
November 20th is the Rule 5 protection deadline, the deadline by which the Red Sox have to add players to the 40-man roster to protect them from selection in this year's Rule 5 draft. This year, at this point, after having added Tanner Houck during the season, the Red Sox, by my count, Ian, have six players that they definitely need to protect from Rule 5. Those players would be Jay Groom.
Mm-hmm.
No question. I think at this point, I think you have to. I think the next guy would be Bryan Mata. No question.
Well, I think Mata's the first one that's getting protected.
I'm going alphabetically.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah. Yes, Mata, yes.
Mata.
I wasn't sure if you're doing like priority, but
No. Mata's priority one for sure. Hudson Potts.
Agree.
I don't think you would have traded for him if you weren't going to protect him.
Mm-hmm.
Jhonny Rosario, same. You wouldn't have traded for him unless you're going to protect him.
I like him. I'm interested, very interested to see him next year.
Connor Seabold, same thing.
Yep.
Connor Wong.
Agree. So that's six.
That's six.
Yep.
Some other interesting guys.
Mm-hmm.
Eduard Bazardo.
I still maintain he should have been drafted last year, and I don't know why he wasn't.
Yeah. It's like, on the one hand, they didn't protect him last year, and he didn't get drafted. I think it might depend in part on what teams are seeing at Fall Instructional League.
I would agree with that. I think it's telling that he is there. Like, you know what I mean? Like, he's one of the older guys there. There aren't a lot. He's already 25. Like, there aren't a lot of hot minors guys there. He had 32 innings in Double A last year. I think he's there either to play his way into being protected or into a trade or showcasing him for another team.
I could see them moving him.
I agree. A surprise they didn't protect him last year, because the thing that gets me is, if I was a team that is a lot, and we know a lot of teams are doing this, they're switching a lot of their pro scouting to going off video and TrackMan.
Mm-hmm.
He's like a TrackMan darling, because his curveball spin rate is among the highest in baseball.
Yeah.
So I don't understand how, when his combination of he performed really well. I mean, I guess his proximity, maybe, like, he only had never pitched above Greenville heading into 2019. But
but this is after 2019 we're talking about.
Oh yeah, sorry. You're right.
Having 2020 is throwing us off.
It messed me up. Yeah, you're right. He made it to Double A last year. Like, I was surprised he didn't get picked last year. But
surprised that the Red Sox decided to protect Kyle Hart, not him.
Yeah,
I mean, we already talked about it. If you want to hear about that discussion, go back a year in the podcast.
But yeah, I think that I'm interested to see what happens with him. I think that something could happen with him before the deadline.
I could see the Eduard Bazardo Kyle Hart switch happening this year.
Right? I could also see him. Yeah, I could also see Bazardo getting traded. Yeah.
Yeah. So I could see
him getting picked if he doesn't get protected. So
We mentioned Pedro Castellanos on a prior episode. I don't think there's any chance he gets picked.
No.
Or protected. Cutter Crawford's eligible, but he's coming off Tommy John.
Same thing.
To be clear, it's Jerry Downs and not Jeter Downs who is Rule 5 eligible.
Important distinction.
It's his brother, the first baseman. Going down,
I think the ones are Bazardo, worth mentioning, Bazardo, Castellanos. Johan Martinez has been good at times, but he's just inconsistent.
Yeah, he pitches backwards. I mean, he's pitches mid-90s, weird. But he pitches off his curveball. It's weird.
Like, Alex Scherff.
Scherff is interesting. I think Scherff is interesting, and I think Zach Schellinger and Alex Scherff were two guys that, if there were a 2020 season, could have played their way into either getting picked or being protected.
I agree with that, because both are, like, relievers now who have big when they're on big fastballs and good secondaries. But
we don't know that Scherf is in the bullpen, but he probably would have been. In my opinion.
But Schellinger's just never healthy, and Scherf is just
Yeah,
that's an interesting one because he's not even on the instructs roster, is he?
Nope, neither of them is.
Yeah, I mean, I get Schellinger a little more just because he was in Double A last year, wasn't he?
Well no, because Schellinger, remember, Schellinger started the year in Portland and got demoted.
Right.
Because remember, he like skipped Salem.
But
and
Scherf
then
is someone who like was in Greenville. Like
he was in Greenville. Yeah, I think, but that's what I'm saying. I don't think there's any chance he gets picked now. But I think he could have played it. Say he goes to High A and he shoves as a reliever and goes to Portland. You know, it depends how the stuff looks.
Right.
Jake Thompson, no. Yeah, I think, you know, Mike Schwarren cleared waivers.
Yeah.
No one's going to take him in Rule 5 if they just could have had him on waivers.
I mean, I actually feel like that's happened before, but I would tend to agree it's probably unlikely. Because, like, roster situations change from when he cleared waivers to offseason. But, yeah, I would
guess.
Agree.
Well, but no, because he's got options.
Yeah.
If you wanted to have him in your organization, why not take him in a way that you can option him?
Fair. No, what I'm saying is, though, at the time, maybe they didn't have room or something.
I guess. I don't know.
I mean, I don't think he gets picked, but yeah.
Yeah.
And I think that's, like, pretty much it. You know, it's six guys, and then maybe there's, like, there's Bazardo, and then another after him. I think there's a drop-off, and then another, like, 3 to 4 names. But I think at most they're adding 7. I think it's probably 6.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that sounds right. And, you know, it's kind of funny looking ahead. The 2021 list isn't that great.
No.
It's pretty thin, and not only is it thin, you've got guys like Gilberto Jimenez. Like, will he have played above Greenville?
No, probably not.
Like, I mean, if he had, it'll be like half a season at most above Greenville. Like, that's going to be a fascinating protection decision.
I wonder if
decision.
They're going to, like, push it back a year. Probably not, right?
No, I would hope not. It's already pushed back too far as it is.
I agree with that. Like, I this is a little bit of a sidetrack, but like looking at the ages of the free agents and the free agent classes here is bad.
Yeah, it's
but
not a good one.
Looking at it, like there's no one under the age of like 30, and it just reminds me of how unfair baseball's like contract system is.
Yeah,
like it's horrific that these guys are hitting free agency for the first time at 30.
Like 31.
Yeah, 30, 31, like, 34. Look at Real Muto. Like
Real Muto's screwed. He's a 30. He's going to be 31 next year as a catcher.
It's crazy to me that this is the first time, or Kevin Gausman's hitting a free agency for the first time as a 30-year-old. Like, yeah. He made the majors his first year after being drafted, and he's now hitting free agency as a 30-year-old.
Yeah.
Like, it's just brutal to me. Like, looking at the list, there's only, like, two guys under the age of 30, and it's, like, Taiwan Walker, because he made the majors when he was 18 or 19 or whatever it was, and then the guy coming from Korea.
Right.
And so,
I mean, that's a guy we'll talk about him in the offseason, but that could be a potential fit.
Agree. But like, that was just, as you mentioned, the like Rule 5 thing, it just dawned on me when I was looking at like the free agent list, how weird this stupid the system is. But
yeah,
I mean, yeah, next year there's like four or five logs like to be added.
Jeter Downs, Jaron Duran, who Duran's probably on the roster already, and I could see Downs being on the roster already, to be frank.
And Thad Ward are the three
Thad
logs.
Thad Ward, Jimenez.
It's like Jimenez, Brian Bayo, like
AJ Politi, if AJ he pitches Politi, Shugart,
Sedian, Rafaela, Durbin Feltman.
Rafaela will be too young.
But like, yeah, it's like a bunch of guys who either like they're just relievers or they're too young. So
Feltman screams Rule 5 pick to me at this point.
Like, I mean, a lot's going to depend on what happens with the minor league season next year.
That's true.
And do we want to touch on that now?
Maybe, yeah. I mean, is there anything else? I mean, just to say the rest of the deadlines. I mean, December 2nd is the non-tender deadline.
That's going to be interesting.
Well, I think it's less of an issue this year because the Red Sox just outrated everyone.
Oh, no, I'm not talking about the Red Sox. I'm talking about around
across
baseball.
Very good. Do you want to expound on that?
I just think that we're seeing it already that there are going to be a lot of surprising non-tenders this year because teams are going to be told by ownership to cut payroll. Like a lot of owners are telegraphing it, like Arizona, Cleveland, St. Louis are all their owners are all telegraphing they're going to make their team cut payroll. And one of the ways that's going to happen is non-tenders. So I just think it's going to be interesting seeing like who we're not expecting to be a free agent turns out to be one.
Right. Yeah. And I think that's why you're not going to see a whole lot of movement before the non-tender deadline either.
Like, I mean,
teams are
going
to wait
like,
to see what other teams do.
Like Mitch Moreland is not going to have his option picked up, for example. Like, I guess he's not a non-tender, but because there's probably not going to be the DH in the NL next year, like he had a $2 million player option and he's going to be a free agent.
Is it
like,
two? I thought it was more than that.
Or three, maybe. I think it was 2 or 3 million. I thought,
three.
But
But anyway, like, he's not a non-tender, but like, there's going to be a lot of new guys, I think, coming available that we aren't expecting right now.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's part of why projecting this offseason is so tough. The Rule 5 draft is December 10th. Keep in mind, the Red Sox have the fourth pick in the Rule 5 draft, too.
I think they'll pick someone.
I think there's no question. And I think it's probably, I think it's one of two things. I think it's either a reliever, which is kind of the prototype for Rule 5, right?
Yeah.
Or it wouldn't surprise me if there's a left-handed hitting bench option available.
I was just going to say that, like, some, like, guy who put up gaudy numbers in AAA 2 years ago or something, like, I don't know, like, because you can find, like, I'm thinking back to this year, like, Jared Walsh with the Angels came out of nowhere and hit, like, 9 home runs in the last, like, month of the season. Like, there's got to be some guy like that's hiding in someone's minor league system that they could bring up.
Could be.
Or that they could Rule 5.
Could be.
And I think Rule 5 this year especially is going to be tough and challenging because teams are going to have such limited data to go off of too. So of the decisions, teams are going to make wrong decisions this year, I think more so than past years. And it's going to be about like the Red Sox trusting their scouts and trusting their analytical department and identifying those guys who slip through the cracks.
Exactly. I think that's a very, very good point. I think it's correct. And that is why I have you on my podcast. It's your podcast. It's your podcast too. I'm just kidding. I think that's, you know, that takes us through the end of the year, basically. Who knows what the winter meetings are going to be? I mean, I'm interested, Ian, if the winter meetings are held by Zoom.
Yeah, how does that work?
Like, how does that work?
Because the thing is, you hear about winter meetings, and a lot of it is, like, teams talking to teams in the lobby of the hotel or at the bar, meeting in rooms to talk. Like, it's all stuff that you kind of can't do right now, especially as it's looking.
Do they all,
like,
set up individual Zooms, like it's you and your friend from college, like,
exactly.
Hey, like, let's Zoom at 10. Like,
yeah.
Like, oh, sorry.
You have to make a Zoom date.
Yeah. And like, what if you're running long on the other one? Like, do you bail on the other guy? Like,
I don't know. It's going to be fast. This offseason is going to be.
Text the other guy, you up? Want to Zoom? Like, what? Yeah. Like, yeah.
It's going to be a very weird offseason.
It'll be very, very strange.
Everything. Yeah.
No, not a question at all. Yeah. And the other, let's see, other dates.
So December 10th is the last day of Rule 5, is the Rule 5 draft. So that's the last day of the winter meetings, right?
Yes. Yes. The winter meetings are supposed to start December 6th. They're scheduled to be in Dallas. I can't imagine they're going to happen. There's probably going to be some kind of online thing. International signing period is going to start January 15th this year, Ian. So that'll be a day on our calendar where the Red Sox will bring in a whole bunch of new players. Oh,
I was just about to say that.
Yes.
Yep.
Clarified that with the money the Red Sox, okay, let's back up. At the trade deadline in the Kevin Pillar deal to Colorado, they got Jacob Wallace and they got international bonus money. We think it was something like 160,000 or so.
Yeah.
Dollars. It looks like they only signed one more guy and went just barely over their original allotment, but I think it was just a situation where the Rockies were like, yo, we're done, just take all of it.
Yeah.
And they were like, well, all we really need is like 10K, and they were like, yeah, don't worry about it, just take all
of
it.
But I don't think you can trade that little.
You can.
You can? Okay.
Well, there's increments. But yeah, there's a rule about how much you can trade. There's like increments of how much, but I think it's I don't know. I don't want to look it up.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't matter. But yeah. Anyway. So they needed it to sign the player they signed.
Right, right, right. So it's his Kevin Garcia. He's from Cuba. He got 10K, 25K, 25K. That's nothing.
He's 21. He's 6'5", 210 pounds, and there's not a lot of information about him other than that.
That's about it. We have photos of him signing his contract.
Well, it also, we've clarified a few other of the, I think we've got better info on some of the signings from that we already knew.
We had a typo on one, was really what it was. We had him in as like 140 and he was 100. He was 100. No, we had him as 100 and he was 140.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So they did need that money to sign Garcia, though. So they seem to have used it. I think that the signing period for last year is over. It finished on October 15th. So there will be no more signings.
So there's a dead period until the 15th of January. Good point.
Correct.
January 15th is also the date the teams will exchange figures with their arbitration eligible players. Spring training games are supposed to start on February the 27th.
Mm-hmm.
We'll see.
Yeah.
.. Yeah. Ominous background music. But yeah. And I guess just doubling back then now, Ian, to the point that you had alluded to, latest on the minor league situation. I think by the last episode. Last time on the SoxProspects.com podcast, Major League Baseball had taken over Minor League Baseball, Ian? Had that already happened? Yeah, so Minor League Baseball is not a thing at this point. I don't know. They haven't officially, quote, taken it over, but that's what's going to happen. The Appalachian League, as we said last time after saying the wrong league for like 5 minutes, is now a Collegewood Bat League. Apparently MLB had a call with owners in the New York Penn League recently. This is reporting by Baseball America's JJ Cooper, who's been all over this stuff, proposing to make the New York Penn League also a collegiate wooden bat league. I guess their idea is that the Appy League will be a wood bat league for like college freshmen and sophomores, the premier summer wooden bat league for college freshmen and sophomores. The Cape Cod League would be the premier destination for juniors, and the New York Penn League, or a league including teams from the New York Penn League, and I'll say why I put it that way in a minute, will be kind of like the wooden bat league for rising seniors, which to me signals, for one thing, that they think more college seniors are coming back. I mean, I guess those guys have to play somewhere, but College seniors aren't where it's at.
They're going to be cutting the draft down, pushing it to later. So they need somewhere for those guys to go after the college season ends, but pre-draft.
Right, exactly. So the thing is that not every New York Penn League team is kind of on the chopping block. For example, Aberdeen is no question going to continue to be an affiliated club. They play in like a double A level
park. Their park is beautiful. I've been there before.
We've talked about it plenty on here.
Staten Island or Brooklyn?
Staten Island, I think, is also
safe because they have a brand new ballpark. I think it's them. I can't remember. It's either
and
them
they're,
or
like one, they're, I think they're replacing Binghamton as a double A team, right?
Yeah,
like,
it's either them or Brooklyn. I can't remember which one. I think it's Staten Island, though.
I think it's Staten Island. I think Brooklyn is the one that everyone's saying, like, that park's not old and they're going away.
But I mean, the thing I think we don't know is, as JJ talks about in the piece, is we still don't know the list of who's on the 140 yet. I don't know what's happening with Lowell. 120, sorry. We don't know what's happening with Lowell.
Yep.
I don't see how it makes sense to keep it as an affiliate.
Well, and here's the thing that JJ talked about too, is that the MLB proposal was that it would be a 60-game season. So you're cutting down, you're cutting 8 home dates from these teams that are used to having a 76-game season. Right, so they're used to having 8 more home games, and now it's not pro ball, it's college ball. The question is, will some of these teams want to try and be independent league teams, have a 140 game season, but then also have to pay their players, pay insurance?
Well, that's the thing; it's a trade off.
Yeah, so you know, it's like, are you going to make enough money having more than double the length of the season to make up to will you come out ahead?
Yeah.
Is the calculation they're going to have to do. So that'll be, I'm, you know, it's a tough position for them to be in, and I'm sympathetic to it, but I'm interested in seeing how they're going to decide how to do this.
Well, because the other thing is, we don't even know if next year they're going to have fans at minor league ballparks again.
Right.
Like, we don't know.
At least the first half of the year.
Yeah, so we have no idea what the economics of the game are going to look like. Because, like, a minor league stadium can't, they don't have a TV deal or anything. Like,
well, I mean, the thing is, like, if you have a minor league park, can you do distancing in a smaller park? Like, if you've got a park that holds
6,000, 5,000.
Yeah. I was going to say 15,000 even, but if you've got a park that holds 8,000 people, what's the point of having it half full?
Yeah.
What is the point?
Well, but the thing is, I guess the counter would be that those parks are often half full anyway.
Yeah, I guess that's true.
Like, let's be honest. Like, I've been to many minor league baseball games where I've had no one sitting within like 10 feet of me, and it's been great. So I don't know if that'll be a change for some teams. But then I've been to games where it's been packed. Like, I mean, Portland in the summer, for example.
Fireworks night.
Yeah, Portland in the summer is a zoo.
Yeah.
And, like, I just don't know how they're going to be able to do, like, because how is it going to work with, is Major League Baseball going to assume like all testing procedures too, if we still have to be testing for COVID? Right. Like, there's just a lot of questions about what minor league baseball is
going to
look like.
How about, are you testing players?
Well, exactly. Like, we have no idea what minor league baseball is going to look like next year. And it's, the longer it goes, the more concerned I am, I will say.
I mean, it's a legitimate question. Are you going to have 120 teams?
I think it's a legitimate question if there's going to be like, if there's going to be minor league baseball next year, or is it just going to be another year of like,
teams working out at their facilities with their players.
You do. I mean, maybe next year, instead of doing the extreme of the alternate training site, you have like just extended spring training for the whole year.
That's what I mean. Yeah.
Like we thought they were going to do, right? You just bring everyone to Florida and you say, look, we're staying in Fort Myers all year.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to play other Florida teams. You know, what we might do is go on. Maybe they'll be more inclined to like, okay, we'll send you guys across the state to stay in a hotel for a few days to play some new teams on the other side of the state. But yeah, who knows? I mean, that's a conversation for another day.
I agree.
The other thing, the other article that JJ wrote, and that there's no reason really to get into this, is that they're proposing, MLB is proposing standards for minor league ballparks, which I think
that's a good thing. Yeah. I've been to some parks that are just awful.
Yeah.
And I don't think it makes sense for how much money Major League Baseball has invested in these players and how much money they will make them eventually, or Major League Baseball is banking on these guys making them. Mm-hmm. Or the teams are, that they would want them training and playing in subpar conditions. It's always baffled me, like, that there's never been more focus on nutrition and ballpark facilities for these players.
Why is there no weight room? Why are you making them
why are you giving a guy a $5 million bonus and then sending him to like certain ballparks that are not going to be named, because I don't want to call them out, but like to work out there, like, and to have to play their games there? It just makes no sense to me.
Yeah, it's nuts. Not saying you got to make it, you know, creature comforts at the MLB level, but
no, but like
have an indoor batting cage.
Yeah. Have an indoor batting cage, have a weight room, have, you know, a place where they can actually eat good food, like healthy food, not just ballpark food, which happens at a lot of minor league affiliates, sadly.
Yeah.
Like definitely things like that.
Yep. Yep. So we'll see on that. All right. Our first email for this episode, Ian, comes from Matt in Cumberland, and he says, hi, Chris and Ian. He made a point, Ian, to say hi to you. So good for you, Matt. He says, thanks as always for the podcast. It's been my favorite part of the 2020 season. To be honest, one of the best parts of 2020 as a whole. That's faint praise, but we'll take it. Listening to the last few season wrap-up episodes has gotten me thinking about old friend Rusne Castillo, whose tenure on the Red Sox has now come to an end with fewer than 100 MLB games played, 99 of them to be exact. Do you think his time with the club has had any or will have any effects perhaps on the way they evaluate and compensate international talent? Do you think we'll remember him as anything but a blip on the team's balance sheet in 10 years, 5 years? I'd feel honored if my email was the last Rusne email ever read on the podcast. Keep up the amazing work. I always love seeing you guys in my podcast and Twitter feed. Thanks. Thanks for the email, Matt. Good. I like it. Good email. Ian, look, I think Castillo was signed so long ago that any change has happened already.
I agree. I think they've already corrected.
Yeah, I think it's just you can't. Well, first of all, I guess you can give out major league deals. It's just you're not giving that kind of money.
Well, but like, what's his name? The Korean shortstop free agent is going to get something like that this offseason, though. Like, I'm not saying from the Red Sox, but you know, he's a similar situation. He's a established pro. He's 25. I guess he's a little, what was Rusne when he signed? 26?
Something like that. I'll bring it up.
And he's coming over and he's going to be looking for a long-term deal at big money. So, I mean, it'll be interesting to see if the Red Sox get involved in that. But I think we've kind of seen the correction already, though, because since Rusne, they haven't really signed anyone like that. I mean, looking at the international page, or if they had, like, I don't count Johan Moncada either, because he was a unique case.
Wasn't he even before, though?
Was he?
Because Castillo, they signed in 2014. They signed in August of 2014.
He was the same year, actually.
Yeah, but was
he March? No, Moncada was March 2015, so he was after.
Oh, right, because it took them forever. It took him forever to sign, I remember.
Yeah,
right.
Moncada is a different case because of how good he is.
Well, he was also young. Like,
yeah, he was a prospect, and that's why they blew past. But since then, they haven't signed very many. They haven't signed any like older international free agent for a significant bonus. Looking through the thing,
yeah,
you know,
he was 27 when he signed.
Yeah,
yeah.
So I think that that's just they're erring on the side. I think we're seeing a correction around baseball as a whole because there's no guys coming over from the foreign leagues anymore that are getting contracts like that.
No.
You know, like even get last year, you look back, or I guess what did you say Kikuchi get?
Not he got that. Like,
what?
Not what Castillo got.
I thought he got like 40 million or 35 or something.
Kikuchi.
He signed a
4-year contract. It doesn't say how much on Wikipedia. Why are you doing this to me?
He signed... It's like basically 17. It was 17 million last year. No.
It was a 4-year deal, 56 million.
Okay.
So like, yeah, there's very few deals like coming over for things like that anymore. And I think even coming out of Cuba the last few years, there's not been a lot of talent coming over of the older, you know, generation. Like,
right.
Those guys are pretty much all the ones have come over that are going to.
Yeah.
So I think we've kind of seen the Red Sox correct already. And it'll be interesting to see if they do get involved in the bidding for, I'm going to actually get his name.
the Korean shortstop.
Yeah. His name is,
we should probably stop just saying, yeah, the Korean guy.
Ha Sung Kim, I think. Mm-hmm. It'd be interesting to see if they get involved in that bidding. Cause as you alluded to, and we'll probably talk about more in the next episode, he does fit very well with what they could use.
Since we're on emails, can I vent really quick?
Uh-huh.
The new Gmail logo is terrible.
I have not even noticed it.
I hate it. It's awful. Okay. Our next questions come from Matthew, often in Parker, Texas. And he has two questions, Ian. One, do you think that the Red Sox might take anything away from the instructional training that they did this year that they may weave into minor league seasons going forward? It seemed like some players like Hauk and Pivetta got big benefits from the additional instruction that this format allowed. Might the Sox have an additional insight during the minor league? No, bleh. Might the Red Sox have an additional site during the minor league season where players could go to work with coaches on specific things, a new pitch, cleaning up their windup, working on their swing, training at a new position defensively, and then go back to games to practice the instruction? I think we've talked a little bit about this previously, Ian, so we shouldn't belabor this point.
Extended spring training basically is this.
But it's not like you take a guy who's in Double-A and say, hey, just go down to extended spring training for a month.
No.
Unless he's hurt. I think you'll be more likely to see that, but I mean, I think the thing. I mean, you have to put the guy on like TIA or something.
No, that's the problem, is like the roster rules limit what you can do with that.
Yeah. And then he says, I have a theory about Dustin Pedroia. Given his tenacity, I don't think he wants to give up on his career and might be doing everything he can to prove he has more to prove. He has more to prove. I think he means prove he has more in the tank or something.
I think he has prove he has more to play maybe or something.
Yeah, I don't know. Anyway, I'm guessing he is working out like crazy to see if he can come back next year. That might be the reason the Red Sox are unable to settle with him early on his contract. I mean, a guy who can hit 300 with a broken bone in his hand surely isn't going to go easily into retirement. Isn't that what we love about Dustin? Thanks for the email, Matthew. By the way, I just realized the subject is 3 comments/questions. So you forgot one, Matthew. I mean, that's Dustin Pedroia. It doesn't mean that the Red Sox shouldn't cut him.
Yeah. And the thing is, it's not cutting him. Like, I think that's harsh in saying they should just cut him. Like,
it's
releasing him in the last year of his contract. And if they do it, as you said, it's going to be like something where they're going to have a joint statement. You know, they're going to have a press conference with him.
Right. You're not just going to find it in the transaction line.
Yeah.
Someday.
It's not going to be like a come out of nowhere thing.
Yeah. I mean, they need to see where he's at. If he feels like he's, you know, I don't know. I mean, I could also see them just carrying him, but I hope they don't.
Yeah.
Our next email is from Pat. His email, 3-way trade/blockbuster. Ian, you ready for this?
Mm-hmm.
Wanted your thoughts on this 3-team deal. The Yankees received J.D. Martinez and Nathan Eovaldi. The Tigers received Giancarlo Stanton, and the Red Sox received Miguel Cabrera plus 3-4 top prospects for both the Tigers and Yankees, because the Red Sox agree to pay a good chunk of Stanton's contract and all of Cabrera's. I realize that this is highly unlikely, but wanted your thoughts. And if you had any other bad contracts that come to mind that the Red Sox could deal for in order to get back a few good prospects. Thanks, Patrick. I'll let you go first, Ian.
I mean, it's fun to think about, but it's not going to happen.
No chance.
Like, the Tigers are not in a position where they're going to dump Miguel Cabrera's contract. He's like a club legend. They're just going to ride out this time with him. And it kind of is what it is, I feel like.
And Stanton produces when he's in the lineup. It's not like he's an albatross.
And
he's
the
just
thing is, why
hurt.
Would the Tigers want Stanton? Like, he doesn't do anything for them. He doesn't make them better. He doesn't make them competitive.
No.
So, yeah.
No, they're going to give up. The Tigers are going to give up Miguel Cabrera for and prospects to receive free Giancarlo's. I mean, I guess that's the point, is Stanton is good when healthy. But
like, the Red Sox also, if they're eating a lot of Stanton contract and paying Cabrera's, that's taking on, like, $50 million. I guess the point is, you're sending out JD and Eovaldi. But the other issue is, I don't see the Red Sox and Yankees making a significant trade pretty much ever.
Right,
so
right,
yeah.
Right. But
fun to
enough.
Think about
fun to think about.
We're in that season.
We are in that season. Next email comes from Austin. He says, "Hi, everybody." So, which I guess that does include you, Ian. "The Red Sox will certainly need to add quality to their rotation for the 2021 season. With healthy minor league pitchers only throwing about 40% of their regular innings this year," good question that he's getting to here, "minor leaguers certainly less. Do you anticipate depth pitching being more important than ever? Going into 2021, are Mata, Seabold, and Hauk enough as 6, 7, 8 options? How would you best add depth? Minor league free agency, trade, guys who pitched in Korea/Japan? Thank you, Austin." It's a good question.
Very good question.
It's a very good question. Guy, look at the Red Sox alone. Eduardo Rodriguez didn't pitch this year, like we just talked about.
Yeah.
Eovaldi is always an injury risk.
Chris Sale's coming back from an injury.
Chris Sale's really coming back from an injury mid-year, hopefully.
Yeah.
Yeah, they need at least, I think they need to sign at least two guys.
I think they need two starters for sure.
I
think that you go all of those routes, whichever one presents the best options, you know.
Yeah.
I would love to see them go out and I think that depth-wise, they are in decent shape, though, because I think they don't want Tanner Houck starting in the major leagues next year. And if you have Houck, Seabold, and, like, Chris Mazza, and maybe even Ryan Weber in AAA is, like, to start next season, that's a pretty solid group depth-wise.
Yeah.
But, I think that it's an area they definitely need to address, and I think they're going to – Chaim Bloom and co. will turn over every stone possible to try to find, guys for that.
It would not surprise me if you look at the Worcester – looking at our projected Worcester pitching staff.
I think it's right, except for I would swap Houck and Kyle Hart and move Kyle Hart to, like, the bullpen or something. But, yeah.
Well, right. Yeah, well, I'm just saying, like, I think we've got Tanner Houck in the majors as, like, sixth starter. I think they signed two guys and push Houck to AAA.
I agree.
But you've got Houck, Mata, Seabold, Mazza probably, maybe Weber. In the bullpen, you've got Feltman, Schwarren, if he's still around, Eduard Bazardo, if he's still around. And then it's a bunch of guys that we think might be there. You could be looking at like 5 or 6 new guys in that bullpen.
Yeah, they're going to have and that's the thing we saw last year, how much that the area that Chaim Bloom turns over the most is, or the front office turned over the most last year, was in the bullpen. And they're going to be claiming a lot of guys on waivers like they did last year for the bullpen, I suspect. And I think we're going to see the same thing. It's just churn and burn at the back end until you find guys you like. And if you find guys you like, you keep them.
Right. Right. So who knows? It's probably going to be guys we're not even thinking about right now. I think you're going to churn the bullpen. I think, who knows? Maybe you churn that last rotation spot if someone comes available.
Exactly.
Mazza, you can start him. You can also relieve him. So, yeah, I think they're going to just churn like crazy. Good question, Austin. Great point. Our next email comes from Raul. He says, "Hey, guys, I know the pitching is the priority, but I feel that Ha-Sung Kim would be great for second base. I saw that Zips projects that he would translate well, and he would only be 25 next season." Is that true? I think he would be 26.
I don't know.
Okay.
He's 25 or 26.
He sent just the Zips projections. And my last question is, we'll start with that. Kim as a fit for second base, the projection, did not mean to do that. The projections on Kim, do you have anything on Kim?
Just that he's been one of the best hitters in Korea. He was 7th in OBP and 11th in slugging as of the 18th of October.
Mm-hmm.
He's played second, short, third. Keith Law says scouts aren't sure he's a lock to stay at short. So, yeah, he seems like he's got a good OBP. He's got power. He's young. I think that it's going to come down to how much money he wants and what kind of contract he can get, because I would assume he's going to go somewhere where he can get everyday at bats. And the one thing is, are we sure the Red Sox are going to want to lock someone in long term at second base, or do they still see like Jeter Downs as the long term second base option, maybe as soon as like the end of next year? That's the question.
The good idea that I saw on Twitter that was posted by our friend Red Sox Stats, who's quoting of his tweets on this podcast, is brought to you by Chico's Bail Bonds. He had the idea, he's like, look, if you sign Kim, then going forward after 2022, when Bogaerts probably opts out, you're going to wind up with some combination of 2 out of 3 of Bogaerts, Kim, and Downs.
Yeah, I don't think having Jerry Downs would preclude them from signing him. I think it's going
to
come down
to... Jerry Downs or Jeter Downs is going to preclude them.
Yeah, sorry, Jeter Downs. I think it's going to come down to what are his priorities. Like we saw with Shohei Ohtani, the Red Sox obviously were very interested in him, but he had no interest in coming to the East Coast. We don't know if that's going to be a situation where he wants to stay on the West Coast. He wants
you know, there's a lot of factors at play, and I think there's going to be a lot of competition for him because, as we kind of talked about, like, free agency is all old guys except for him. So, yeah. It's a good idea. I think the Red Sox are going to be interested, though. I can't imagine they wouldn't be, given his type of profile. Seems to fit a lot of what they're interested in.
Yeah, but I could just see another team. I mean, apparently John Morosi, in his reporting on MLB.com, said the Rangers and Giants are viewed as suitors. The Angels have an opening at shortstop with Andrelton Simmons hitting free agency.
I think he's
Indians, if they trade Lindor.
A lot of teams, like, those guys, it seems like the West Coast is very intriguing to a lot of the guys coming from Korea and places like that. So I, as we saw, like, Kikuchi went to Seattle, Otani, LA, obviously. And then you do have, like, Tanaka went to New York and stuff like that. But it's going to be interesting, and it seems like there's going to be a lot of competition because he's someone who, unlike a lot of these players, he fits with teams that aren't necessarily ultra competitive right now. You know what I mean?
Young.
Like, if you're a team that's, you know, in the middle ground or trying to, you know, start making some noise, that he's the type of player you should be targeting because he's got upside and he's on the younger side and he can, you know, you're buying into his prime, whereas a lot of the other guys available on free agency, you're paying for, you know, their decline or the start of their decline.
I mean, Zips projects him to be like a 270 hitter with like a 340-ish on-base percentage and a slugging between 470 and 490. I mean,
that's like...
That's like a 3.5 to 4 WAR player.
Yeah, that's like a borderline all-star. Yeah. So if that's what he is, like, yeah, he's. I would definitely be interested.
Yeah, for sure. And then the rest of Robles' email, he says, my last question is, do you think a guy like Yasiel Puig would be a good fit? Not right now. Rough timing on that. Righty power bat, doesn't have a qualifying offer and would probably accept the one-year deal because he didn't play this year, so he would be better signing short-term and trying to get a big contract later. So maybe we could take advantage of that. Thanks, guys. How old is Yasiel Puig?
29, right? Or is he 32? I don't know. Do you know?
No, that's why I asked how old
I believe he's 30 or 29. No, he's 29. He's 29.
Okay, so he's not old yet. I don't love the fit. I would rather try and bring Jackie Bradley back for a year.
Yeah, the problem is I don't know if they want to put Verdugo in center field full-time, and I kind of think they need a left-handed bat also in that role. Like, if they bring him in, they're getting very right-handed. So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think that they are interested in bringing Jackie Bradley back as well. I think that's the only reason why you don't move him for whatever you can get at the trade deadline.
Yeah.
Well,
I think the thing with Puig is, like, I guess he was going to sign with Atlanta before his COVID positive test last year.
Yeah.
But
why didn't anyone pick him up after that?
Well, that's the thing. It's like, what were his contract demands? Like, yeah. it's just a weird situation.
Is he going to take a one-year deal?
That's the thing. Like, we don't know what his demands are. We don't know what he's looking for. We don't know what kind of playing time situation he wants. So I'm sure they'll take a look, but I'm not sure he's a good fit.
I don't love the fit either. Next email comes from Bryan in Nevada. He says, hi guys, just responding to something on your last pod on why the MLB draft is the least predictable of the four North American sports. This is a really good point he makes. The biggest reason is that teams can't trade draft picks. MLB teams also have a lot more latitude over how much they can pay their draft picks compared to the other three sports, which all have pretty fixed salary scales. Thus, under slot drafting in MLB, which is pretty difficult to predict. When Bill Belichick wants to draft a guy, quote, under slot, he trades his pick for multiple lower picks and picks that guy later. The team that winds up with the Patriots' old pick chooses a guy who is representative of that pick, a guy who Belichick presumably didn't want for the amount they would have had to pay him. The same practice is common in the NBA and sort of in the NHL. They tend to trade picks for established players more than picks for picks. Just to keep going. The MLB draft player pool is most similar to the NHL's, as both have a mix of college and pre-college player pools, and neither has a single dominant player pipeline like you have in the NFL or, for the most part, in the NBA. But ultimately, the biggest thing that makes the MLB less predictable is the ban on trading picks. Even in the NHL, where you have college, junior, and international player pools, the draft order is pretty predictable because it doesn't matter what team has what pick. The best player left on the board usually goes next. Thanks for stimulating this discussion, Bryan in Nevada. Ian, that's a terrific point, and I feel kind of dumb for not bringing that up last time, honestly. You're on mute.
Yeah, that's a really good email. It is also all fair. And I think that's, I think MLB though has seen what the other leagues have with their more or less slotting system. And that's why they're trying to institute it, because they didn't like the latitude teams had, which was leading to situations where the best players weren't going first. They were, you know, teams were trying to cut deals, assign multiple guys, things like that.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, look, it's, I mean, MLB, I don't get why they don't allow trading of draft picks. I think one point it was because they were afraid the teams would basically just trade out of the draft in time.
That's what they're afraid of. I had this discussion with someone recently, and I was like looking up, and all the research I could find was basically that they were worried that teams were just going to sell their draft picks basically for money.
Right. Which is, I mean, at that point, get new freaking owners.
Or the thing is, like, do what other leagues do. Like, some what is it? I think it's the NBA has rules where you can't trade first round picks in consecutive years or something. Yeah. Like, there's like ways around it. Like,
yeah, that actually got suggested for our fantasy league, by the way, which is not a terrible idea. But yeah, you just make rules around it. But you know, I think at this point, teams have realized that the draft is the best, most cost effective way to build a winning team.
Oh, no doubt. Like, we saw the two teams that were in the World Series this year. Dodgers and Rays are homegrown teams. Like, well, they build.
I don't know about the Rays. The Dodgers are. Rays, I don't know that I agree.
Lau was drafted. I mean,
yeah, but a lot of those guys like were traded Thomas. For.
I guess he was a trade, but he was brought up through their system.
Yeah, but they trade Austin their Meadows guys for prospects
acquired. Like, they trade for prospects.
They're homegrown in the sense that they take their guys who graduate out of being prospects and who they're not going to be able to pay and trade them for more young, cost controlled guys. So it's
correct.
Kind of a,
but they do graduate.
They till
them
the
from
soil. Yes, they till this. I mean, hell, they've got the best prospect in baseball.
Yeah, I mean, but like Blake Snell was drafted by them. Shane McClanahan was like, they have a lot of guys they've brought through their system.
Yeah. Next question comes from Michael. Michael says, "Love the podcast." He says, "Hey guys," so that includes you, Ian. "Love the podcast slash site. I was wondering if you saw anything from Brustar Graterol this postseason that made you think the Red Sox should have kept him in the deal. Or better yet, never trade Betts in the first place. Haha. Down seems to have higher upside, but it could just be that watching this year's bullpen made me kind of wish we had an arm like Graterol. Keep up the great work and enjoy your offseason, Michael." Ian, I would not think twice about trading Downs straight up for Graterol.
What, you would rather have Downs, I assume?
I would not trade Downs for Graterol.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, like,
or how about I would not trade Downs and Wong for Graterol?
Yeah, because you got to think you got both of them. Like, this is the thing with me. Graterol, he's a 22-year-old in a bullpen, which is a red flag. Like, a guy with his kind of stuff and his kind of, like...
Strangely doesn't miss bats.
Well, I'll get to that. But his kind of stuff and his kind of, what's the word I'm looking for here? Pedigree, excuse me. I couldn't even think of that word. His pedigree, like, that should be a starting pitcher, or at least try him in the starting rotation. There's a reason they didn't try him there, because they're afraid he's going to get hurt. And that's why the Red Sox nixed the deal. You know, there's injury concerns with him. And then second point is, you said, yeah, it was good. He doesn't strike anyone out. Like, and it makes no sense given his stuff is filthy. But in the regular season, he struck out 13 guys in 23 innings. In the playoffs, he struck out six guys in eight innings, or four guys in eight innings. I can't remember. It's one of the two. And it's just one of those things that's a little concerning that he's just not missing bats at all. And I'm sure Graterol is going to have several really good seasons in the bullpen. Yeah. At the end of the day, I'm taking the chance at an everyday second baseman and, you know, a fringy catcher over a reliever. Like, as the Red Sox have shown, you can find relievers everywhere. And a bunch of the Rays, I think, are the best example of this.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
They find relievers literally anywhere and turn them into good guys. Like, Peter Fairbanks has had Tommy John surgery twice. Like, are going back to a different team in the playoffs. Like, Chris Martin is like a shutdown reliever for the Braves now. And the Red Sox had him, and he got traded, I believe, for who was it? Yvonne Herrera or someone. No, who was it? Jonathan Herrera.
Yes.
Yeah. Like, you can find good relievers. The good relievers are a lot easier to find than good everyday players at second base. So yeah, I wouldn't make that swap.
And they're just so fickle.
That's the thing. Like, Graterol could be great next year again, and then he could blow out next year and never come back as the same pitcher. Like, he clearly has injury concerns, red flags. And yeah, as you said, relievers, like, I mean, look at this year, for example.
Kirby Yates was one of the best pitchers in baseball in 2019. He stunk this year.
Exactly.
Blake Treinen was one of the best relievers in baseball 2 years ago. He was not good this year.
And last year was terrible. Predicting reliever success from year to year is kind of a fool's errand. Like, very few guys are going to be consistently good for five, six, seven, eight, 10 years. And, you know, I'd much rather take the chance at the position players than have Graterol. Like, I think you can find guys like him either in very other ways.
Agreed. All right.
And this is the other thing is, like, they're already getting skewered for the best trade. Imagine if their return was a reliever. Like, if their return was Verdugo and a reliever, they would be destroyed even more than they are now.
That would be terrible.
because the Gratterall would have been sold as being a starter.
Yep.
And yeah, so.
Yeah. All right. Hey guys, good morning. This next email comes from Will. He says, good morning. I hope all is well. Do you think the Red Sox should draft the best available player at fourth overall and conduct a similar strategy to what the Miami Marlins did this year? Best regards, Will. I guess, Ian, maybe you know more than me. The strategy that Miami did, I mean, they took Max Meyer at number four, which was like a little bit of a surprise.
Like, yeah, he was ranked like eighth or something.
I mean,
and they signed him for a little under slot, and then they gave big money to a bunch of pitchers later.
I think that you do that, though.
You have to have extra picks. You have to have extra picks.
You have to have extra picks.
Which is Miami. Miami had an extra first round pick, or an extra supplemental.
They had a competitive balance B pack.
Yeah.
Pick.
Yeah.
A, that. B, I think it's a situation not unlike with the Red Sox and York, where you're doing it because you know you can get the player for a lower bonus, but you also see him as worth the pick.
That's the thing. And the reason you would take a guy, if the Red Sox take someone who's not ranked by like BA or MLB, ESPN, all the other publications as a top four pick, it's because they have him as a top four pick on their board. And he's the best available player on their board.
Or at least close.
Yeah, at least like comparable. Like they're going to take, that they wouldn't be taking someone who's projected to go like, or who they have projected as like a late first round pick at number four.
Right, exactly. Exactly. Even if they're going to take a guy there. Okay, look, we could take the guy that we have number four on our board, or we could take the guy we have number six on our board. But if we take the guy at number six, we're going to get an extra $1.5 million of bonus room. Like, okay, yeah, take the six guy.
Yeah, because I'm looking at it right now. So they signed Meyer for he signed for 6.7, and those slot value is like 7.22. So that they saved like 500,000, and then with their next pick. With their second round pick, they took Dax Fulton, signed him for 2.4, pick value was 1.86. So literally like the savings went to that.
Right. Right. So it's like, you know, are those two players better than the, you know, if you have, you know, BPA versus, you know, I mean, what did Austin Martin wind up getting?
6.1, I want to say.
And what was slot for the Marlins pick?
No, he got 7, and slot for the Marlins pick was 7.22. So he got slightly under slot. He got 300,000 more than Max Meyer did.
Okay. So, yeah, I mean, it's like, do you see him as $300,000 better than
But I think the Meyer? Thing is, like, in the Marlins' eyes, clearly Max Meyer was the number one pitcher on their board because they gave him a bigger bonus than Asa Lacy got, who went with the next pick.
Yep.
So it wasn't like the Marlins were, like, you know, dipping down their board. They took who they perceived to be the best available player.
Right, right. Right. But all right. Thanks for the question, Will. Our next question comes from Harrison. Hello, gentlemen. Great to hear that you're recording another podcast. It's been 3 quiet weeks. Tell me, do you have any idea why the Red Sox have not yet received their player to be named later from the Cubs for Josh Osich? I've assumed from the start the return would be a lower level minor leaguer. Thanks, as always, for your great website and podcast, Harrison. No, we don't know.
I don't know if they're going to get one. I still maintain that I thought it was and or cash consideration.
That's literally every...
I know you keep saying that, but the fact that they haven't received it, what is to stop them from the Cubs being like, well, he was only on a roster for like 2 days.
It depends what they agreed to at the time.
We don't know if they agreed to anything. Like, it could have been like, if he makes our playoff roster, we'll give you a pit player. And like, if he doesn't,
that's my point. It's not like the Cubs get to just decide, you know what, just kidding. That's what I'm saying.
No, I understand.
And I know
that's
not like, what you're saying, but that's what it sounds like what you're saying.
What I'm trying to say is just that I think if the reason that we haven't heard anything makes me think they might just be getting cash and not a player. That's my point.
I get that, and that's fair. I thought Bloom had said at the time of the trade deadline that they knew all the players who were coming back.
I don't know.
I thought that he had said that. So if that's the case, I don't understand why we don't know yet. It could be often it's like you have a list to scout from. And maybe they're scouting their instructional league right now.
Fair. That's the other. That could be it. But yeah.
That could be it. Who knows? Our next email comes from Andrew. 2 more, Ian. Hey, guys. I was wondering if you see any potential market inefficiencies to be exploited by an ostensibly big money club like ours in this weird COVID era, either with regards to splashy moves, discount on a long-term deal for a star free agent, Bauer on a big one-year deal, or the more granular things that fans like me don't follow as closely. Maybe there are just too many unknowns right now, and ultimately I do trust Heim Bloom to sort it out, but I can't resist indulging in this kind of speculation. Thanks, Andrew. I mean, sure. It's just, are you willing to spend, right? I mean, that's the question.
Well, yeah, like if they claim Brad Hand, I think that's an example of what he's talking about.
Yeah.
Because it's a mid-market team like the Indians, didn't want to pay him. No small market team's going to pay him. They have financial muscle and they're willing to flex it. Like
if they do it, yeah. I mean, that's
like that's an example. I think it's going to be like going after non-tender guys. You know, if someone, or even like Colton Wong, for example, will they go after him and try to offer him a one-year, $8 million deal? Like they can take advantage of other teams not willing or being unwilling to spend and target the guys that they had to let go to cut cap. Like that's definitely right. Something they could do. Or again, I wonder if they're going to explore like a Will Myers type trade that didn't happen last offseason with the team, you know, get a decent usable player and a prospect in order to take his contract, something like that. Like,
yeah, I mean, I think that the problem is it's like, you know, the Red Sox also have laid people off.
Yeah.
Right.
That's that's the flip side, is the optics of it. If you're if they go out, and that's why I don't think they're going to sign a big money free agent, like the optics of laying 10% of their works of their staff off,
which is still less than other teams did, but still,
oh, it's a lot less, but still
it's the optics of, you know, look, I think that they'll spend money. I think they could spend up to the cap. They're not going over by 20 million again.
They're not going over the luxury tax this year, I don't think. We'll right. See. Or what,
they
what's
might.
The number? Yeah.
I don't know. I mean,
I think though that like, but like my,
I don't think they're going to, but I think they might like eke over it.
Like, for example, would you call, if Arizona was willing to give you like Christian Robinson for you to take on Madison Bumgarner's contract?
Hell yeah.
I'd strongly consider doing that.
Yeah.
Like if Bumgarner's your number five starter, yeah, it's 4 years and what, 80 million or something left. But if you're the Red Sox, you can take that if you want to, like something like that. I think they're going to explore. We don't know if there's a deal like that to be had, but yeah.
Yeah.
All right, well, Ian, I think let's wrap it up. I want to thank all of you for the download. Thank you to our supporters on Patreon for the support. Thank you to the Ludlow Thieves for our intro and outro music. Thank you to Podcast Joe 2.0 for a tremendous job on a tough lift with this one, separating the different segments out and splicing them back together. It's a thankless task, or can be. I don't want it to be thankless. So thank you, Joe. We appreciate it. Follow us on Twitter. You can follow Ian at Ian Cundall. That's IANCUNDALL. Follow me at SP Chris Hatfield. And make sure you're following the site at Sox Prospects. Ian, we're finally wrapping up on the news page. I've got it scheduled for Thursday, the 2019 final edition of our draft retrospectives.
Mm-hmm.
It's finally up. We need to get James on here at some point to talk through it all.
Yeah, I think we'll it's going to be great off-season chatter, because if the off-season is slow, which it looks like it's going to be, we'll need some
chatter.
Topics, and we have 16 drafts or 15 drafts to talk about.
We do. In addition, Instruct stuff, I've been meaning to ask you, are we going to put some stuff up, or are we just going to do updated scouting reports? What's your plan?
We'll put some stuff up, too.
Okay,
cool. It'll be coming in the next couple of weeks.
Beautiful.
Probably over the next like month or so, it'll be coming.
Yeah, we've got a lot of stuff.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot. For reasons we haven't been able to really talk about Instructs, but there will be stuff coming from it. So
yeah, we wanted to wait until it was closed for a number of reasons.
So yeah.
Plus the thing is, I mean, you know, great, you know, you get information from a start, and then a guy has three more and he's good, right?
Well, especially on this year where it's like some of these pitchers haven't thrown in game situations since spring training, like,
right.
minor league spring training had barely started. They had just reported when the thing got shut down, so a lot of these pitchers haven't thrown, you know, since either winter ball last year in a game situation, or maybe a little in spring training, or even Instructs last year. So that's why it's like one of those things where it's better to wait and let people settle into their routines and get some reps under their belt before you read into anything. But they played for a while. It's over now, unfortunately, because the weather kind of banged the last few days.
Do we know that they sent him home?
I believe so, yeah. And so, yeah, we'll see. It's going to be interesting. Kind of, we haven't really talked about it yet, but doing the ranking process, how we're going to value Instructs, and then the reports. There's some interesting developments down there.
Yeah, I mean, there's Instructs. It's like, how do we value that? How do we value, I don't know, what's happening in you know, what happened at the ATS?
How do we value what's going to happen in the winter leagues? Like Jaron Duran's playing in Puerto Rico. I assume the Puerto Rican players will also be down there. Maybe some other guys. There's some guys playing in the Dominican. So, yeah, it's going to be an interesting offseason.
It is going to be. Yeah, there's a lot to look forward to in the offseason. I'm seeing it.
And then the Red Sox are going to make massive changes, too. So, yeah, we're going to have a lot to talk about. We can maybe talk about Francisco Lindor on the next episode, even, because we have very different opinions on that after seeing what you said on Twitter.
Really?
Today.
All right. I look forward to that one. Okay. All right. That'd be good. We'll finally disagree on something. I'm sure it'll go over well. All right. Well, thank you all for listening, and we'll be back in your eardrums soon with another episode.